Good morning. Thank you. First of all, thank you for the invitation and the great introduction. So I'm Simon. I'm 28 years old, and I'm the co-founder of Plastic Odyssey. So I'm here to share you my everyday learnings about how important is the human factor when considering addressing a problem that seems at first rather technical. So it all started a few years ago when I was back at school with a friend of mine, realizing how polluted is our beloved ocean. So we were studying at the Maritime Academy at the time to become merchant navy officer. And we realized that plastic pollution was just everywhere. Every minute, it's about 18 tons of plastic dumped into the ocean worldwide. And at first, when we saw these kind of photos, of pictures of plastic pollution, we thought, okay, the solution is clear. We're just gonna take a boat and clean up the ocean. There's a technical problem, so we have a technical solution. We just need to clean the ocean. But very soon, we realized that it's not gonna be that easy to tackle the problem. Because when the plastic enters the ocean, it soon degrades into microparticles. It actually doesn't float at the surface. The picture that you saw is just here to raise awareness. It's pictures that are taken on the coastlines, but they don't reflect at all what is at sea. This is a picture of the Great Garbage Patch in the Pacific Ocean. You might have heard of it as a big island of trash. Well, it's not at all like that. This is a real picture. It's just crystal clear ocean with small tiny particles everywhere, but invisible and obviously impossible to gather, to collect, and to clean. There's actually less than 1% of the plastic we put in the ocean that remains at the surface. The rest just sink at the bottom or degrades into microparticles. So the solution to this problem is a little bit more complicated than what we thought. As I was telling you, there is a lot of plastic flowing continuously in the ocean. It's like a tap widely open, flowing at a rate of 18 tons per minute. So the idea was, okay, there is no plastic floating, as I was telling you, but where is the tap? Where can we close the tap? Well, this is actually, for 90% of the plastic that enters the sea, it comes from the poorest countries that don't have access to waste management. So this is an example of Lebanon that is just surrounded by waste and trash. And as you can see, it's very close to the ocean, so when the wind or rain is happening, it just pushes the waste into the ocean. So this is where we needed to act. So we thought, okay, these trash are whether left on land, or at the worst case scenario, they are just open burned, like here. Whereas it can be turned into resource. It's at the beginning, it's quite a precious material, actually. It has a value, and you can, if you turn this plastic back into new plastic, you can actually build houses like here, or new materials, building materials. Or you can also make fuel out of it. When you cannot recycle it anymore, you can turn this plastic back into diesel and gasoline. Do you have any idea of how much oil you can get from 1 kilogram of plastic? Well, you can get actually 1 liter. So this has obviously a value. I'm not saying that this is the fuel of the future, obviously, because this is just a transition when avoiding extracting oil and burning the plastic at the same time, but just turning this waste into a new resource to avoid it just remaining on land. So the problem is, These technologies exist, but they are reserved for industrials, so at a big plant, big factories, and they are not adapted to the countries that would benefit the most, meaning Africa, Southeast Asia, or South America. So the idea we had was to develop small-scale solutions at very low cost, small technologies to recycle plastic, and putting them open source, meaning free of patents. So we just build systems that are low cost, and we share the drawings everywhere so that anybody can take it, replicate the machines, and recycle themselves, the plastic. So that was the idea at the beginning. There's basically three steps. So first, sorting. So that's what we are focusing on. Sorting the plastic, how to differentiate PET from PE, so the different types of plastic. This is a big issue, but you can actually, with a simple sensor, detect and segregate the plastic. Then recycling into new materials. So as I was showing you, for building materials, for example, bricks or tiles. And the last step would be turning, so gathering the energy of plastic. This is called pyrolysis. This is the three steps we are working on now. And in order to share them, to spread the solution, the drawings, we thought we need to do like Solar Impulse. I don't know if you remember this project, the plane that went around the world powered by solar energy. The idea wasn't to build plane powered by solar energy, but it was to be an ambassador of renewable energy and prove that if you can do that on a plane, you can actually do that everywhere. Well, we thought we need to do the same with plastic pollution. We need to take a boat, a research vessel, and to transform it into an ambassador of all these different solutions to take plastic waste and turn it back into a resource for local communities. So that's how Plastic Odyssey was born. And today, so we have a 40 meters long research vessel that is split into two areas. So the first one at the aft of the ship is dedicated to plastic recycling solutions. So it's basically a big laboratory where we will test all the different steps from sorting to recycling and finally turning back into fuel to power the ship in energy. And so we will test all these machines to experiment on the field and then share the drawings, as I was saying. And at the front of the ship, the area is dedicated to reducing plastic waste. We decided to do that few months ago, actually, because we realized that if we were only focusing on plastic recycling, so the technical part, as I was telling you, there was actually a problem. Because people were telling us, well, that is great, you know, you found solution to the pollution, you have technology that can recycle plastic, this is great. But we knew it wasn't the case, it was just a way to clean up the past somehow, to get rid of the errors of the past, but we shouldn't, because we have solution to recycle some of them, think that we should continue just consuming single-use plastic and do the same errors. So that's why we thought, okay, we need also to make people understand that this is not, the technical solution is not going to solve everything. And usually what I realize is that everybody is very keen on technologies. In media, you can see that everybody is talking about this incredible technology that we, whether clean the ocean or save the earth from climate change or anything. But this is actually more complicated. And what I feel now as an engineer is that technology is not the only key to solve a problem. It's just a small factor of the solution. And the human factor is the most important. So here we are to talk about it, right? And that's why we wanted to make this boat, turn this boat into a laboratory of human factor as well. So we decided to embark on our ship, anthropologist and designer that will work on how, first of all, how to implement the technologies and fit them to a different culture everywhere. Because obviously, if we build technology for Europe, it won't work in Africa, it won't work in Asia. So you need to adapt the system and make it fit to a specific culture. So that is the first point why we wanted to add this research on a human factor. And also the second point is, how can we nudge people to consume less plastic and reinvent the way we use this material that should be used for only precious uses? And that is the objective of the fourth part of the ship, thinking about how we can live without plastic, how we can make it sexy to use a reusable bottle rather than a plastic bottle. All this work on that. So this boat will really be a research vessel on all the different ways to tackle this plastic pollution from a technological point of view, as well as from a human point of view. So here it is. She's called Plastic Odyssey now, and she's still under construction. Refitting, actually, we bought a former research vessel, and now it's in a shipyard to be turned into this incredible lab. And it will, so the expedition will start next year, in 2020, from the south of France, from Marseille, and we'll set sail, first of all, to the Mediterranean coast, so Lebanon, Egypt, Morocco, all the countries, the south of the Mediterranean, and call in each of these countries to test the machine, demonstrate, and then spread the solutions. That will last 3 years, so then we will go to Africa, then South America, South Pacific, and then Asia, and then back to Africa. And what we want to do with this is, in the long term, build a global network of small initiatives everywhere in the world that can turn pollution into new solutions. That's the basic idea. So obviously it needs to be, create businesses, local businesses, so that people can live from that, otherwise it won't work. So that's the main focus we have, but not without forgetting that the social part is the most important in this challenge. Just to show you some pictures of what we've been doing last year, so before launching this big expedition, we built a small boat, 6 meters long. She's called Ulysse, and it was the first proof of concept of the project. So we took a former small catamaran, and we put on board a machine that we had developed that could turn plastic back into oils. That was not a boat that would clean the ocean, obviously, but just a demonstrator that shows that we can build actually small scale at low cost systems to turn plastic into a resource. And the idea was to power this ship only with plastic waste, like in Back to the Future. So that was really powerful. The message was quite powerful. And we went, so we built the machine with a team of engineers and industrial partners. And then we put that machine on this catamaran. And it was christened by the French Secretary of State of the Environment, Brune Poirson. And then we went all around France, so different in Monaco and in Marseille, and we ended up in Paris on the rooftop of the Galerie Lafayette, which was quite a symbolic step for us, because 100 years back, a plane landed on this rooftop, and we thought, okay, now we need to put a boat and talk about environmental conservation, ocean protection. So that was more symbolic. And now we're ready for the big project, the big expedition. So as I was telling you, we've just acquired this 40-meter long research vessel last month. And I can actually show you. So this is the project, if you have the question, usually I have this question, like, if you do open source, how are you gonna fund the project. It's by sponsorship, like Solar Impulse, so that we can build systems that are free of patent, that don't need a return on investment. So that's how it works for the moment. And I just wanted to show you this small video of the arrival. So we acquired the boat. It was a German vessel at the beginning, and then we went to take this boat and to put it back to France. So as you can see, the boat is really now still in the research oceanographic research mode, and we will transform the aft of the ship, put another deck, and put all the machines. The paralysis unit would be at the aft of the ship, and in the middle we will have all these different shredders, extrusion machines, stuff. So this is quite a good tool to spread the word, let's say. And to end up, I wanted also to tell you a small story tale that I like. I don't know if it's a French one, but it talks about frogs, so should be. It's the story of the crazy frogs. I don't know if you heard about that. It says that actually frogs are always moving in hordes. They're all moving in groups. So when the horde of frogs is crossing a highway, for example, they all die, except from some of them, few frogs that are called the crazy frogs. Nobody knows why they are choosing another path. They're choosing another direction. And at that sort, they save the species, actually. When the horde of frogs is just crossing the highway, the crazy frogs are finding another path, maybe under the highway. So I want you today to maybe become a crazy frog and stop following the path and try to find alternative ways, whether it is the human approach or anything, but just find this path and help save the world. Thank you.